Wow.
In Chicago. Yeah, it's kind of crazy. And then, you know, tonight there's like maybe 45, 50. And it kind of averages around, I'd say, between, you know, 40 and 70 people around there.
Oh, that's awesome. Wow. Yeah. And what do they get with that? Do they get like a autograph poster and like a meet and greet with you, Devin, and the rest of the gang? And
yeah, I guess what it does is it gets them into the show. It got them. When you purchased the ticket, you got a digital download of the album before it was released.
Oh, perfect.
You get a poster signed. You get this flag of basically the tour poster as well. And, you know, we sign all that. And you get a laminate and all that kind of stuff.
Okay, so you actually go all out for this.
Yeah, and what's the other thing? You know, it's like basically they can come across and meet all the bands because between the Baird and me and the DTP are splitting it. So both bands are there. And then once they meet everyone, it's an open question thing. So all the fans can ask any member in the band or band question or whatever they want to either or both of the bands. And we answer questions for them.
Oh, that's great. Wow. And now is this a add-on or is it like, does it include a general admission ticket or no?
Yeah, it includes a general admission ticket, I believe. That's what I gather anyways. We don't put it on. It's another company that does it. But from what I understand, it includes the ticket as well.
Oh, okay. That's great. Because I did. Okay, allegedly. But if it does, that's great. Because I know a lot of bands that you have to pay through the nose for, you know, a concert of them. So yeah, that's basically like maybe $40, $50 after fees and delivery charge and all that other thing. And then you have to pay an extra $200 to meet them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I mean, I unfortunately did that for the Used.
Unfortunately?
price-wise. I mean, they were great guys. You know, they were very, you know, happy to see you. You know, they weren't just standing there like Justin Bieber.
Yeah.
Like when he did his meet and greets where you had to pay like $2,000 and then like some days where he's like, I don't feel like fucking doing this. And then they got like a picture with a cardboard cutout. I'm like, wow, what a fucking douchebag.
Are you serious?
You didn't hear about that?
No.
Holy shit. Yeah, that was a big thing. I think in Toronto, I want to say. And it got word out to the Darkness who decided to give... They were playing a local show there, and they said, okay, the first 25 people to show me your Justin Bieber VIP laminate gets a VIP with us. No strings attached, no nothing.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's just a complete douchebag move, man. It's like, you just don't do that. You know, it's like, this is the thing, man, when it doesn't matter if you're the level of Justin Bieber, or our level, or Metallica's level, whatever level, it doesn't matter. These guys, including ourselves, are not here if the fans aren't there in the first place.
Absolutely.
So Justin Bieber is absolutely nothing without the fans who support him, and especially the fans who pay crazy money to do a VIP. So, you know, that's just a slap in the face, and that's gross, man. It disgusts me when bands are like that, because you know what? They should be thanking their fans every single day for where they are, because without them we're nothing, man. And that's why, you know, whenever we finish a show, there will be tons of people waiting by the bus every night after a show, and we always take the time to sign whatever they want, take pictures, because without them we wouldn't be there in the first place. So, you know, I hear things like that, and it's just, that pisses me off, man. But you know, hats off to the Darkness for acknowledging that and going, you know what, this is what it's all about. And then they did that, you know, so I'm really impressed by that.
Yeah. Not to mention they gained new fans doing this. I mean, it was 100%. Basically all expenses were paid to go out to this show and to meet them and then go see an amazing rock band.
Yeah, exactly. But that's very cool, man.
Yeah, definitely.
Dude, well, I would have been demanding a refund if I showed up and I had to take a picture with a cardboard cutout.
Yeah, exactly. There was no refunds whatsoever. That's how like absurd this was.
Damn.
Man, you know what? I'm surprised you didn't get sued for that, because, you know, you're paying to physically meet that person.
Yeah, getting the product that was offered.
Yeah.
Yeah, like it's false advertising, you know? It's like, I can't believe no one sued him for that, you know? It's like...
Yeah. Although his personality might be a cardboard cutout, but you never know.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I mean, if anything, it's great to hear, and if people hear this podcast, they know that at least you guys are the real thing, and you care about your fans, and realize if they weren't there, you guys wouldn't be anything. So it's great to hear.
Yeah, and both bands say that Between the Buried and Me, they're the exact same way, right? They're great people, and they get it as well. It's been an awesome tour, and we toured with them back in 2010. So to go out with them again is a total treat for us, because we love those guys, love their music, and it's musically a great match, and personality-wise a great match as well.
Yeah, definitely. And it's basically you're maybe one or two bands off from being like a prog metal fans' wet dream. Like, if you throw in like Animals as Leaders and Fallujah all on the same tour, holy shit.
Yeah.
But wow. Yeah,
sensory overload, man.
Yeah, really.
Know your time signatures.
Yeah, exactly. Jesus Christ. So you're actually in New Orleans right now at the Joy Theater, right?
Yeah.
Nice, man. Nice. And this is about what, halfway through the tour, or is coming to the bare end?
Yeah. Yeah, we just crossed the halfway point about maybe 4 or 5 days ago. We go on to, what is the date? October 15th is our last show in Vancouver. So, yeah, we're just over or just past the halfway mark, and it's been awesome. The shows have been packed, and great crowds every night. It's awesome because, you know, co-headlining shows, you never know. Sometimes you can get a crowd where it's, you know, BT BAM heavy, or you'll get a crowd where it's DTP heavy. Mm-hmm. But we haven't run into that once on this entire tour. Like, by the time, you know, BT BAM hits the stage, it's packed, and when we're finished, it's still packed. So it's been a really good bill, man.
Yeah, that is great to hear, because there's a lot of, and I'm guilty of this myself. If I know if I'm going out for a certain band, and I'm not too thrilled about like the headlining band of the night or the band that closes it out, I will leave early. I mean, I'm just one of those. It's human nature, more or less. It's a music fan. You're fickle. Nope. You're there for who you want to see, and that's basically it.
That's it. Yeah. You know, and luckily, you know, lots of BT BAM fans are fans of us, and vice versa. So, like I said, it's been working out great.
Yeah, and I guess that's good, you know, with marketing and stuff. If you pair the right bands together, you know, you get those crossover fans that are fans of both, and then they'll stay, you know.
Yeah.
Exactly.
There we go.
How was that Saints game?
That was awesome, man. That was Beav and I are big sports fans. Dev and some of the crew members ended up going out too, and Dev's far from a sports guy, but I think he just wanted to take in, you know,
experience it,
what the atmosphere would be like, the experience of it all. He was pretty blown away.
Now, were you
know, like on his Twitter, he even said, "Man, I'm glad I'm not high for this."
Are you a Saints fan or a Atlanta fan?
Well, I was cheering for the Saints. Just because it's a hometown. It's the first NFL game I've been to. I watch the Super Bowl every year, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not a huge NFL fan, but, you know, it's like I'll wake up on mornings and stuff on the weekend, and I'll watch it, or Monday Night Football with some buddies. Mm-hmm. And I always watch the Super Bowl just because, you know.
It's the Super Bowl. Yeah. You got to watch it.
I'm obviously, yeah, you do, right?
But, well, you're not American if you don't.
Well, he's not American.
No, I know. I'm a big hockey fan, so.
Nice. What team?
It's all about the hockey team for me, or hockey in general. But yeah, I'm a huge Vancouver Canucks fan. Always have been. So, you know, it's like I love watching hockey, man. But, you know, I kind of follow I've been a Seahawks fan because it's closest to Vancouver.
That's true.
And a few of my buddies are big Vikings fan, Minnesota Vikings. So I kind of keep tabs on both those teams.
Nice, man. Nice. Any what about the Vancouver, was it the Whitecaps and the MLS?
Yeah, no, I don't follow soccer very much. I used to play it when I was a kid. It was fun to play back then, but not a huge fan of it, man. Yeah. You know, just it's too slow. Like, I like faster moving sports.
To be honest, I used to be the same way until I went to a New York Red Bulls game, and for some reason a switch flicked, and I'm like into it like crazy. But I was the same way. I'm like watching on TV. I'm like, how does anybody find this entertaining? All they do is pass back and forth. You know, when I was a kid, it was literally just like take the ball and run up the field and do some moves and score. But I don't know. I just got into it after watching all the crazy ways they score goals and stuff. I'm just like, I don't understand how people can't like it. But then again, now, you know,
I don't necessarily dislike it. I think it's a great sport. It's very strategic. And
it's like golf. We love to play golf, but I personally don't like to watch it online or on TV.
Yeah. So, you know, but, to each your own. It's like, I love, like, I'd say my two favorite sports to watch are tennis and hockey being number one, tennis number two. I used to play tennis a lot, so and compete and stuff. So, you know, I love those two sports, and not a surprise, both are very fast moving sports, you know, lots of action constantly and strategic, you know. It's just, I don't know, I enjoy it. But to each their own, you know. It's like, on the flip side, I love watching golf. Love playing it too.
Yeah, I just got into golf. I was out in Vegas when the Masters was going on, and I bet it. And I swear to you, if you want to get someone into a sport, have them bet on it. They will become like a fucking expert within like an hour of watching.
Come on, you fucker, make the bet.
That's true. It's true, man. Yeah, and probably the only other thing that I'm really big into is I've always been a fan of the UFC.
So same here, man.
I'm a big, big UFC fan, and, you know, I have a couple buddies who train. One guy actually runs a school, and for his age group and belt categories, he's won the world championships in jiu-jitsu 4 years in a row.
Holy shit.
So, yeah, so he's a good buddy of mine. So it's like, I've trained with him a couple times and done that stuff, and I find that sport really interesting too, because, again, it's very technical.
You
know,
lots
of people, they sit there who know nothing about UFC, or I should say about MMA, not UFC, but just MMA. They don't know the technicality when it goes to the ground and stuff, and, you know, the jiu-jitsu angle of it and stuff. And, you know, oh, they just sit there and hug each other and roll around. You know, like Dev actually used to say that all the time.
I'm guilty
and
of that.
He used to slag the sport, man. And now he's gone to a couple of Dave Young. Well, Dave Young doesn't teach MMA, but he teaches some sort of fighting. And Dev went to that and realized how strategic and how technical fighting can be. And then he started watching the UFC fights lately, and he's like, oh, I get it. I love it. It's cool, you know. So, you know, it's I don't know. I love technical sports. I love sports where, you know, it's very strategic, and you gotta, you know, make sure you're making the right moves, or it could cost you the game or the fight or whichever.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, once you're on the ground in UFC, I know so many, even boxing fans, like, oh yeah, they're really hugging each other. They're like 3 seconds away from getting like their oxygen cut off. Like, it's just like, you know, it's going from the half guard to the full guard to the mount. It's just like insane. I mean, there are great fighters that are like that are great on top. Like Roy Nelson, he's great. Has that overhand punch. It's just like one.
Well, one of the best guys for that, hands down, and he's coming back, is GSP. And I'm not just saying that because I'm Canadian, but his record speaks for itself. You know, it's like. And yeah, in his earlier days, he'd finish fights and knock people out, but no one can beat the guy, you know, because technically he's so sound on the ground and so good at jiu-jitsu that if they make one mistake, they're getting choked out, and then they can't control anything from the bottom because he's just has amazing ground and pound. So everyone comes out all bloodied and battered, right? So there's lots of guys. Like, look at what happened to Conor McGregor when Nate Diaz took him down. Like, I knew that was over in seconds because Conor has no ground game.
Yeah.
So it just goes to show, if you don't know your shit when it's taken to the mat, it's game over, man.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know,
it'll happen fast. But yeah, it's cool, man. I dig it.
So does all of this, like, bringing up like technical sports actually translate into your music? Is that what made you go, you know what, I'm sick of this whole 4x4 thing. I want to do something different. And then that's what made you get into like maybe prog rock and then, you know, what you're doing now?
No, you know what, just music in general. The main reason I got into it is my father's a piano player and he played in cover bands when I was growing up. And my brother and I would always go to his sound checks. And then when they'd finish sound check, I'd always run up to the drums and just bash around, right? And his drummer eventually is like, man, your kid really likes the drums. He's actually trying to keep a rhythm too, which is kind of cool, you know?
Wow.
And my dad asked me, do you want to play? And of course the answer was yes. And the rest is history, right? But that's what truly influenced me to get into music. And then, you know, like I learned basic songs from AC/DC and stuff like that when I was learning at first. But at a young age, I think it's like 14 or something, I found Rush. And that changed everything.
No, of
great
course.
Band.
By the time I was 17, I could play all the records because I just studied it so much, right? So, yeah, you know, that's what really, I'd say, got me into prog music was Rush, hands down. You know, like, Neil Peart was my first massive influence on drums and still is, you know, and you can hear some of his stuff come out of my playing every once in a while. But, yeah, you know, I'd say that's what really influenced me into prog music and drumming.
Mm-hmm. Oh, awesome. Have you ever seen Rush live?
Yeah, four times. I believe it was, yeah, four times.
Wow, awesome. I can't believe they – I know I understand why they hung it up, but I thought that was a band that's just going to do it forever.
Yeah, me too, but, you know, they're doing it for the right reasons, and they went out on top. You know, yeah. It's like they're at the top of their game still and selling out arenas, so – you know, I wish I saw this last tour, though. I'm kind of bummed that I didn't. But I was on tour, so there was no way I could get to the actual show.
Damn, nothing aligned up.
Pardon me?
Nothing aligned up. Your tour and their tour were in like, the same city, or?
No, nothing like that. I would have went. Damn. I always look for stuff. Whenever we're in cities or we're about to go on tour, I look for hockey games or sporting events or, you know, I'll look for just a whole bunch of different things that we can do, right? Like, that's why when the Saints came lined up last night on a day off in New Orleans, I'm like, oh, I got to go. Never seen an NFL game before. So, but yeah, it would have been cool to catch Rush on the road somewhere. But, you know, our tours weren't even remotely close to each other. So,
yeah, that sucks. Actually, do you know the comedian Bill Burr?
I've heard of him. I don't know him, though.
Okay.
Like,
well,
no, I've never seen him or anything like that.
Okay. Well, he's a comedian. He's been doing it for years. He's a ginormous sports fan. He ended up, he does gigs around big events, like big sporting events. So if, let's say, Florida State is playing somewhere in Florida on a Saturday afternoon, he would do a weekend of shows in Florida. And like, he's gotten to that level where he's like, okay, you know what? I'm just going to book myself here. I'm going to book myself here. And he just does that like to coincide with sporting events. And I think that's fucking genius.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Yeah.
It's a good way of catching your sporting events.
Not to mention, I'm sure most of those tickets are comped anyway, because someone at the comedy clubs knows someone in the arena. And
yeah.
Wow. you know what? If he can do it, I'm sure you can do it too. You just have to get Devin on board with that.
Yeah. That would be the key point.
Yeah. So now you're actually coming up to close to 15 years with Devin.
Yeah.
Jesus. So how'd that whole thing begin with him?
2002 when we started, yeah.
Yeah, wow. So how did everything come about with you and Devin?
Like, how did I get the gig?
Yeah.
Basically, I played around Vancouver a lot. And long story short, when I moved to Vancouver, I didn't just focus on one thing. I didn't put all my eggs in one basket. I opened as many doors as I could, so I started to teach. I'd do session work. I played in a pop band. I played in a rock blues band. I played in a metal band. And like I said, I was teaching and doing session work on top of that. So I'd do country sessions, you know, rock sessions, pop sessions, metal sessions, and punk. I even did a couple punk records.
Wow.
And it just got my name out there all the time. So when Devin went around asking people, you know, who would be a great guy to replace Gene for doing all my, you know, solo stuff, because Gene Hoagland, the Strapping Young Lad guys, were doing his solo stuff along with us while, but he wanted to separate the two. My name just kept on coming up. Everyone's like, RVP, have you heard of RVP? You know, so finally he's like, who the fuck is this guy? And he reached out to me. One day I was just sitting at home and I get a phone call. My call this place is Devin Towns. I'm like, what the fuck? So it was a trip, right? And the funny thing was, I at the time didn't understand Strapping Young Lad at all. I actually thought they were a complete shit band. I'm like, wow, this all I heard was City. They hadn't done the Feather record yet.
Yeah.
And I was just like, this is the worst sounding production and music I've ever heard in my life. It's absolute shit. You can't even understand, you know, when you get to the middle of Oh My Fucking God, you can't even understand if there's a beat happening. You know, it was just so intense, right?
It was just like, noise for you. Yeah.
Yeah, it was brutal, right? So, but the funny thing is, I went home from a rehearsal one night, and my bass player was driving, and he puts this album in his car, and I'm just listening, like, this is fucking amazing. Who is this? And it's like, it's Ocean Machine. It's Devin Townsend. I'm like, this is Strapping Young Lad. He's like, no. He has his solo stuff too, which is completely different. I'm like, well, this guy should do this for a living, because that's fucking 10 times better than other people doing. You know, and so anyways, I thought it was awesome. I went out the next day and bought Ocean Machine. And not a word of lie, 2 weeks later is when I got that call.
Jesus.
Crazy.
Which is fucked, because a lot of my tryouts, there were two or three songs out of the five that were from Ocean Machine that he wanted me to try out, right? Like, I think Regularity was one, Life, and Seventh Wave. I had to learn Earth Day, and what was the other one? Truth.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
From Infinity. So those were the songs that I had to learn, and yeah, you know, it was like, loved it instantly. And I got the gig, you know, I tried out and got the gig right away. And then, you know, we were jamming for maybe 5 or 10 minutes, and he just stopped the jam. He's like, he looked at me, he goes, you're the guy. And damn. I'm like, fuck, we haven't even jammed your tunes yet. He's like, no. He goes, I can tell you're the guy. And I was like, crazy. All right. And, you know, then, you know, I got to see Strapping Young Lad live a bunch of times. And you could hear in the mix the actual music versus the production on the record. Then I got it, and I became a huge SYL fan. You know, it's like, because I could understand and actually hear what the music was. So, you know, eventually I ended up really enjoying Strapping and everything they did. It's just, you know, even to this day, when I go back to City, I have a really hard time listening to it. You know, it's just, the production's just so over the top that it's really hard to hear some of the parts and some of the songs. But great music, though.
You know, absolutely. Like,
especially live, man. It was so heavy, so crushing.
Wow. I think it might have been Between the Buried and Me. First time I heard, I think it was maybe Alaska. I was like, okay, what the fuck are they doing? It's, you know, it's like, here we go, death metal, and then prog, and then, you know, like random other shit. I'm like, yeah, this thing sucks. Ended up catching their Colors tour, and they played, I forgot what song it is, where they had that little country breakdown in it, and it just fucking whacked me in the face. I'm like, oh my God, what the fuck is going on here? And then I just, like, just, it was so absurd that I was like, all right, I fucking love this. Then I went back, and Alaska still kind of sucks for me. But, I mean, they have a lot of great stuff, including their cover album, The Anatomy Of, I believe. And just craziness. And, like, that band is just fucking tight as shit live.
Oh, they're amazing live. Blake's always blown me away as a drummer. Mad respect for that guy. And just all of them, like, Paul and Dusty are insane guitar players. Dan's a killer keyboard and bassist.
Yeah.
Tommy's super talented as well. Like, they're really talented dudes. And, really fun to hang out with. Like I said, it's an a pleasure to be touring with those guys.
Now, is there any band or drummer or musician out there that when you see them, you're like, shit, I still got to practice. I got to catch up to this person.
Yeah, there's, if I were to say a band, I'd say Meshuggah. And if I were to say a drummer, that's easy as well. That'd be Gavin Harrison.
Porcupine Tree. Yeah.
Yeah, that guy is the best drummer on the planet, in my opinion. Man, he can do anything, and he can do it flawlessly. Man. You know, it's just like he's got so much technique, so much, you know, groove and flavor to his playing. It's just amazing, man.
What do you think about Mike Mangini from Dream Theater?
Oh, he's a phenomenal drummer. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought he did a phenomenal job, you know, replacing Mike Portnoy.
Yeah,
you know?
Definitely.
So, he's a great choice, and he's a monster, man. Like, there's so many amazing drummers out there, but, you know, I think the reason why I like Gavin so much is just he brings a certain spice and flavor that only he can bring, you know. And it's so obvious when you hear him drum. It's just like, oh yeah, that's
him.
Gavin Harrison, you know. It's like when you hear Neil Peart drum, you know it's him.
Exactly.
You know, or it's the same with Stuart Copeland, you know, or guys like that. And so, you know, they've created their own brand, but I think Gavin's just like taken from guys like Peart and Copeland and Vinnie Caliuta and stuff. And he's like the new breed, you know, just insane.
Just,
you know,
like a morph of all of them.
Yeah, like, I know he's a big Steve Gadd fan. You know, it's like, he's just taken all those things, but he made it his own, which is the best thing you can do. Yeah. That's what I say to all my students, is be a first-rate version of yourself, not a second-rate version of someone else. And, you know, create your own brand. Now, don't be competitive with people. Learn from them.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, the only person you should ever be in competition with is the person you were yesterday. You know, it's like, that's it. That's, you know, there's this whole fastest drummer in the world or best drummer in the world. That's a bunch of shit, man. It's a pile of shit. It's like, whatever. You know, it's like, you can categorize that in a million different ways, you know? So I think the best thing you can do as a musician, a drummer, artist, or anything is just be the best drummer for that song. Mm-hmm. You know, do what's right for the song first. And then, you know, you can add your spice to it whenever you want. Mm-hmm. And if you're more versatile and you can play several different styles of music, and with feel and groove and have chops at the same time, that's what's going to impress me. Whether you're a guitar player, drummer, singer, whichever. You know, and that is one thing that impressed me about, for example, Between the Buried and Me, is they can play, go from a country thing to a death metal thing to a rock thing to, you know, they're pretty wacky band, man, but that does it really cool. So it's inspiring to see guys like that at work.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. So I actually put in Transcendence in the car on the way up here, and I got up to, I think, Lights, I want to say. I was almost through the entire thing, and holy shit, what a fucking phenomenal album, man. Oh, we're on hold. Damn it, Ryan.
Go flip the button on my phone. Okay. Go, Ryan.
Ryan.
This is not going to be in the recording. On the side. Just push it down. And we are good. Except for Ryan, though. I don't know where he went.
Ryan. But anyways, he's out with the Devin Townsend Project. Well, he's a part of the band. They have a great new album out called Transcendence, and charted actually number 117 on Billboard 200, which is, oh.
Hey, Dan.
All right, we're back.
Sorry about that, man. That's right. My wife was calling me, and I'm on my iPhone here.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, and so I didn't know this, but if someone makes an actual cell phone call, they'll put Skype on hold. So you learn something new every day. Sorry about that.
We had that on another podcast, I think.
Yeah,
I
forgot who it was. And yeah,
approaching Troy, that local band.
Wow. But anyways, where the hell was I? Oh, yeah, Transcendence.
Yeah.
So I actually read up that it's the first album not produced solely by Devin. And you also got Adam Nolly Getgood from Periphery. Where did that whole thing start from? Was it Devin just going, all right, you know what? Let me try something completely different. Let me get another take, or...
Well, okay. Devin tried to do that, the album before, with Z2.
Mm-hmm.
And he actually tried doing that with the engineering side and mixing side with my brother, his name's Jay Van Buderoyen, and he's a pretty big engineer / producer in L.A. with a guy named Brian Howes. And, you know, they record guys like Nickelback and Chris Cornell and Avril Lavigne and just like A-list artists. Like, it's big shit. They were, you know, Brian got his big break with co-writing the song Lips of an Angel with Hinder 10 years ago.
Oh, yeah, that song that everyone knows.
Yeah, exactly. And Jay recorded that. So Jay's like super talented, insane engineer. You know, he's always gotten my best drum sounds. Like, the best drum sound I've ever gotten was with Nolly, hands down, with Devin's stuff, for sure. And Jay did record and get sounds and dialed in Dev's guitar sound stuff when we were in L.A. recording Z2. But the problem was like, you know, Dev gave Nolly a lot more control of the mix and engineering aspect of it this time around, where that's what he wanted to do with my brother with Z2, but he didn't in the end. You know, like when it came to the mix, my brother had a certain mix, but then Dev came in and it all changed. And it ended up being another Dev record, more or less, with my brother more or less engineering, even though he did help in the mixing. But it's not what my brother's mixes sound like whatsoever, not even close. You know, so you know, it was a different thing, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas this time around with Transcendence, he gave Nolly way more room and let Nolly do his thing and just put trust into engineering and especially mixing. Because Deb was still in with the mixing, but not nearly as much as it usually is. That's why the album sounds so radically different from all of his other records. And yeah, that's how it came to be. Nolly didn't produce anything. He was just an engineer and a mixer on the record. Devin produced the whole thing.
Gotcha.
But yeah, and that gets mixed up quite a bit in a lot of interviews. But yeah, Nolly came in and he engineered the drum sound. I think he did the same with the bass and mate and chipped in a bit with the guitars here and there. And the big thing was his mixing credentials really helped us a lot on this record. And I believe that's why it's, you know, the best sounding DTP record there is.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm guessing, you know, you're obviously out on tour for this album. How many songs from that album are you playing live and where was the reception of those?
Right now we're playing 3 songs. We were playing 4. Secret Sciences was in the set list, mm-hmm. but the reason it got pulled is because of crowd reception. It just did not go over live.
Gotcha.
And I love that tune. We all do, but you know, when you just play something live and people are like standing there going, okay, I think it's maybe because it's a slower plodding song, mm-hmm. you know, and it is a bit long and different parts. And a lot, like the verse goes on for quite a while. It's the same rhythm. It's kind of hypnotic, right? But for whatever reason, it just didn't go over. So, you know, the other 3 songs that we're playing in the set, they go over awesome and people love them. So we're going to continue playing them.
Yeah, might as well.
But we're representing a lot for sure on this record.
So when you so that's basically what it comes down to is crowd reception for picking the songs that you play.
Yeah, like especially for new stuff. Mm-hmm. But you know, when we chose all the old stuff that we're going to play, with all the old stuff, you know, we just choose it and nothing's changed because we kind of know what they're going to like and what they're not going to like. And then we pull out a couple gems that, you know, maybe we haven't played in a while. You know, like, for example, not to give too much of the set away, but mm-hmm. we pulled out By Your Command from Ziltoid, the first Ziltoid record. And that's a fan favorite. Like, everyone loves that tune, right? So we knew that would go over and we hadn't played in 3 or 4 years. So it made sense to bring that back in, right? So we do little things like that to keep the set interesting. I think this is the best set we played in years, to be honest. So it's a really good one.
Wow, that's awesome to hear. I love when, you know, bands aren't too new album heavy and they always throw in some fan favorites. Because I know, like, if you're really promoting this new album, they'll be like, okay, so we're going to play, you know, 7 songs from this and then leave you with, like, what, like 4 more songs. It's like, yeah, we'll play a best of right now.
Yeah.
But...
yeah, no, there's we just sprinkle enough of the new stuff, and you know, it's like we're just at the start of touring. It's our first tour for this record, and we're gonna do tons of them. So, you know, we'll change it up. We'll get some other songs in there and flip it around and do different things. You know, especially if we come back and we do a second round in the States, we'll make sure that we add some different tunes from the record as opposed to the ones we're playing this time.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, and I know the U.S. isn't really the biggest for prog rock and prog metal. What countries are, like, they go absolutely apeshit for this?
Well, Europe's kind of a given.
Yes.
The thing is we're actually, like, this tour especially, we're pretty blown away. You know, we're playing 2,000-3,000 cap places and packing it. Mm. So it's starting, and then, you know, we still play, like, there's a few gigs where it'll be 700-800 people or 1500, you know, it's like, but it's been pretty impressive for us. Like, we're really happy with the turnouts we're getting in the States now, but Europe's a given, you know, mm-hmm. that place is pretty much a given for having good turnout for prog music. Japan's always been amazing. Australia's great. You know, South America goes apeshit for us, you know, but really? We just don't get down there enough. Mm. And, it's hard because, our booking agent says it's just hard to book tours and get the right amount of money to make it, I guess, worth it for us to go down there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't want to come across the wrong way by saying that, but, you know, it has to make sense to bring our production, the show, and the budget that it costs to bring it there. Mm-hmm. It has to make sense, you know, for what, you know, the promoter's offering to pay and tickets and all that stuff, you know, all behind the scenes business shit that we don't deal with. You know, we just get word where we're going and then we go, you know, but yeah, those pretty much everywhere, man. The reception's amazing, but I'd say Europe is number one when it comes to prog music for sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think going back to touring, what people don't realize and maybe don't even think about is it costs a lot of money to put on a tour with bands, and a lot more people than you would think need to get paid. So if it's not somewhat beneficial, why would you book it?
Well, that's exactly it. And unfortunately, that is how it works. You know, it's like when you have a tour bus, you have a full crew and all these things going on. People don't realize how much it costs to actually put these tours and shows on. So you have to take that all into consideration, right? You know, it's like people say, oh, well, you do a Ziltoid show in America. It's like, well, if the demand's there and people are willing to pay the money of what it costs to put on a show like that, then yes, you know, we will. But, you know, if you want to pay 15, 20 bucks just to see a Ziltoid show, you're not going to see it, man. You know, because it costs a heck. If you guys have seen the Royal Albert Hall Blu-ray,
yeah,
like that's how Devin wanted to put it on, you know, and we sold that out in a day, you know, like Royal Albert Hall sold out in one day, right? So the demand's there, and that's why we do a lot of our stuff over there, is because these big shows with all these theatrical settings, we're able to pull something like that off in a place like London because the demand is there. So, you know, so that kind of answers the question about, you know, going down to South America or the places that we don't get to go very often. It's just, you know, the demand needs to be there in order for us to bring the show there.
Absolutely. And, you know, it speaks a lot highly about the whole band's character, meaning you're not going to go down there and just play for like a couple of strobe lights going off. You know, you're bringing the whole fucking thing. Like, what you're seeing is what you're getting. You're not going to half-ass it wherever you go.
Yeah, that's right. So, and you know what? Like, we have tons of fans on there. They always, you know, want us to come down there. Even when we went to Santiago, Chile a couple of years ago, we headlined this festival in a place called Movie Star Arena, and it was packed. It was like, you know, 12,000-13,000 people or whatever it was, and down headlined one night and we headlined the last night, and you know, it was awesome. So like, there's definitely demand and stuff like that, but you know, it's just a matter of the demand, you know, and and the people wanting to do that, right? And trust me, we'd love to go anywhere, everywhere, you know, but it just has to be, it just has to make sense. Mm-hmm. That's all.
Absolutely. And, you know, as a music fan, you have to respect that. Like, you, and also to every music fan out there, you know, if this tour is coming around, I know you're more than halfway through, but if it's coming by you, go out and see it, because look, the, you know, you and the rest of the band make most of your money basically with these tours. You know, it's not, you're not getting like a lot from record sales, even though you just charted 117 on the Billboard 200, which is pretty fucking awesome. So congrats on that.
Yeah.
But I mean,
oh, thank you.
Yeah. And it's just a lot of people are like, yeah, you know, I'll get it the next time around. It's a Tuesday night. I don't feel like going. You know, no, you motherfuckers. Go out, support the bands you love, because without you, they can't do this. And the last thing you want to do is just go, shit, oh, they're breaking up? Fuck, and they're not doing another last tour? Oh, I missed my shot. You don't want that feeling. Trust me, that feeling sucks.
No, and like I said, it goes both ways. It's like, we can't do this without the fans. And, you know, if the fans aren't supporting us, then that'll be the day this ends. You know, it's like, so, you know, and in the world of downloading and all that shit, every band bitches and complains about it. It's like, it's just the way the music industry has evolved, and the bands that deal with it and just charge forward through it and keep on pounding away are the bands that I think are going to be, you know, have more longevity instead of the bands that just sit there and bitch and complain and then eventually break up because of it, you know, and right now the true fact is, you know, we need to tour, you know. Without touring, there's no way we can do this. So that's what we do, you know, and we have a really good group of guys here, and the music's awesome, and the fan base is awesome. And so it's a, believe it or not, it's an excellent and awesome situation to be in, all considering how the music industry is going these days. So, you know, you got to be grateful every day that you know, you can do something like this. And again, we're very thankful that we have fans that, you know, allow us to keep doing this.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I know you got a show tonight. I'm really thankful for you coming out and doing this interview. You know, it took a little bit, but I'm happy we got a date working out, and this interview has been nothing but awesome. Do you have any plugs you want to share before you go, besides get Transcendence and come out and see the rest of the show, or the tour rather?
Yeah, well, you know, basically, like, the main thing I always like to get across in interviews is just that, you know, it's an honor for me to be playing in this band. It's an honor for me to be doing this for a living. And, you know, like I said, I'm grateful every day, and I can't get the point across enough that, you know, without the people who support us, I'm not doing this. Mm-hmm. So, you know, first and foremost, just thank you to everyone who does support us. It means the world to not only Dev, but us as well as the band, right? Mm-hmm. None of us can do this without them. So extremely grateful for that. And, you know, just the support that, you know, you guys, you know, interviewing us and doing this thing, spreading the word, it's huge. That's how we're going to keep this train rolling, you know. So that's the biggest thing that I'd like to, you know, plug or whatever, is just thank you. You know, it's like plain and simple. I wouldn't be talking to you right now without all the support that our fans give us. I don't even like saying fans, the people who support us, you know, our supporters. That's more like it.
Yeah, fans and, have that, like, weird godlike mentality. Yeah.
Which I do not like at all, right? So, yeah, our supporters, the people who appreciate our music, you know. And other than that, man, it's like, you know, you can always catch up on everything on me on my website, www.rvpdrums.com. It's linked to, like, my Facebook artist page, my Twitter, Instagram, and all that. And then there's also stuff on heavydevy.com. Mm-hmm. Devin just put up a brand new website as well. There's lots of cool stuff on there. It's a very intuitive and cool website to navigate through. So between those two sites, you'll be covered everything DTP and RVP. So check it out.
There we go.
All right, great.
Awesome. So before you go, we usually ask the artists we're interviewing if they would like us to play a song to... basically, like an outro from this interview. Is there anything that comes to mind?
Now, what are you talking about? Like from us, or
yeah, for one of your songs, more or less, or it could be from anyone. It doesn't matter.
I'd say my favorite song from Transcendence is "Failure." So, rip that one up, man. I love that tune.
There we go. All 6 minutes of it.
All right, man.
All right, Ryan. Have a great show tonight. Have a great rest of the tour. And next time you're over in New Jersey, New York, we'll definitely come on out.
That sounds great. Thanks a lot.
No problem, man. Thank you.